But we're going to be in Acts chapter 5, and what we're going to talk about today is street fighting. I know some of you guys have probably have a little bit of experience in being in a street fight. About maybe five, eight years ago, we had some fun on Friday afternoons. We hired Mike Delahanty, who is a Krav Maga expert. Okay, he's out of Freehold now, Counter-Strike Krav Maga, and we had him come to my office every Friday as sort of a gift to our employees and something fun to do as a team, and we had Mike teach us some basic Krav Maga moves. And for those of you that don't know, Krav Maga is an Israeli defense system. It's a military defense fighting system that was invented for the Israeli Defense Forces and their security forces, and it's derived from a whole bunch of different fighting techniques, MMA, all different types of MMA, boxing, Aikido, karate, kung fu, wrestling, judo. And the guy that created this did it in a way where he was able to teach the average person how to quickly defend themselves in case of an attack. And there's actually two versions of Krav Maga. There's the Israeli defense version, where they have such secretive techniques that if you live in Israel and you are a military, trained military specialist that knows Krav Maga and you want to teach it to the public, you have to be supervised by an Israeli CIA, quote-unquote, intelligence officer to make sure that you're not giving away too much. What we learn is some of the simple techniques, but that are very, very effective. And Krav Maga basically teaches you three things. Number one, it teaches you not to underestimate your opponent and to expect the unexpected. One of the things I loved about it is that it taught, especially having the kids do it, is that it taught mental awareness. So when you're in a situation, let's say you're coming out of a mall and you're walking through the parking lot at night, if you've taken Krav Maga, you're not just ready for a fight, but you're also thinking and watching your surroundings. You're looking for the different threats. You're also saying, where's my escape route going to be in case there is a threat? You're also looking for different things that you can use as a weapon. That is one of the really cool things about Krav Maga. You can basically take anything and they teach you how to use it as a weapon. But the first thing they say is never underestimate your opponent or what they are planning and expect the unexpected. Number two, one thing I love about it, is it teaches you to confront your opponent with a very skillful, practiced, rehearsed technique. When there's no other way to escape. That's the cool thing about Krav Maga. They don't try to teach you to be a tough guy and say, go and take everybody on. They say the first thing you do when you're attacked is look for a way out. Get out. But if there is no way, that's when you can use your weapon. And that's funny because if you ever saw the movie Roadhouse, it's one of my favorite movies. It's not a great movie for kids. You got to fast forward some parts. But Patrick Swayze was the head bouncer, which they call the cooler. He's basically the one that runs all the bouncers. And when he took over this really crazy roughhouse bar, he said, everybody, look, there's basically three rules. Number one, never underestimate your opponent. He said, number two, always take the fight outside. And he said, number three, always be nice. And if they're not being nice and you try to take them outside and you can't get it outside, only then, when there's no other option, do you start a fight in the bar. And that's the thing about Krav Maga, look for a way of escape. Some of the techniques that they use, that they practice, are really cool. Gouging of the eyes, okay? Poking of the throat, bending back fingers, kneeing and kicking in the groin, okay? All these places, hitting the knees. So when you practice these things over and over, they are very specifically trained techniques that you have in your mind as you're being aware of your surroundings. The number three thing that they do is they teach you And actually, this is something that Mike actually taught me, because when we started getting into it, we really started taking it. We brought it to my house and we started putting gloves on. And I loved it up until the fact that he started hitting me for real. He was like, he wanted to spar. And I was like, remember, Rob? I was like, I don't want to do this anymore. I don't want to get hit, you know? I got one more fight in me and I'm not losing it on you, you know? I'll get knocked out and I'm going to be busted up, you know? But he explained to me that when you get into a confrontation and you have an opponent, the one thing that you have to reconcile is that you are going to get hit. You are going to get hit. And he said, if anyone ever pulls a knife on you and you choose to stand up to that person because you have no other way to escape, know you're going to get cut. If you're going to stand up to an opponent, know you're going to have to take a hit. And that's one of the hardest things that happens when you think about it. But here's the biggest thing and the best thing I love about Krav Maga. It allows somebody with very little natural fighting ability to face a difficult opponent. Somebody that has very little natural fighting ability can, let's just say a frail, tiny woman, like my daughter Leah. She, okay, if she learns Krav Maga, she doesn't have a lot of ability at 11, 12 years old, but she could use these techniques. And that's the one thing I love about it, because, and how we're tying this in is, as a, like I was thinking about Acts chapter 5, and Acts chapter 5 is all about these apostles learning how to endure and learning how to confront some of their most difficult opponents. And I was thinking about the Christian life, and we cannot be victorious in our Christian life by our own natural ability. We face difficult obstacles, we face difficult challenges, but we have to follow a very unique, prescribed battle strategy and use specific tactics that God gives us in order to not only defeat our opponent, but in order to follow God's individual call in our lives. There's a battle plan that God has for us. And I look at the Christian life, because the Christian life is really, when you think about it, it's like a difficult street fight. Because it's like that, we have to go to God and we have to see, how do we move forward? Now, this isn't about physical fighting. See, this is much more difficult than physical fighting. If the Christian life was just about fighting, I would be very happy, because I would commit my life to learning how to fight, right? What was the movie we were watching the other day, Zoe? I forget. We were watching a movie about one-on-one fighting. What was it? Apocalypto? What was it? Blood sport? No. It was a movie about like the old battles, you know, sword fighting and all this stuff, and where they didn't have guns and all that. And I said, if I ever lived back then, when my whole life was dependent upon one-on-one combat, that's all I would probably practice, right? But the Christian life isn't like that. Here's what we're up against. The Christian fight is not physical. It's a fight to surrender to Jesus. It's a fight to obey Jesus, to suffer for Jesus, to deny ourselves, to have self-sacrifice, to stand and follow the truth, follow God's truth, even though the world is telling us that we're not to do that. It's to love our neighbor that's unlovable. It's to fully love God with all of our heart. And most important, it's to follow God in where He calls us to go in our own specific journey. That's what the fight is about. But like in Acts chapter 5, we have some very difficult opponents. So we're going to look at the very first difficult opponent that we see, and we're going to learn, number one, the very first technique that we have to learn as a Christian to follow our call is to never underestimate this opponent. So let's look at Acts chapter 5. Now notice, Acts chapter 5 starts with the word but. Now anytime you see the word but, But is what they call a coordinating conjunction to connect two different phrases. But is there so that you look before it and see what they're trying to connect, what's about to come. Now, I think Acts chapter 4 should have actually ended at verse 31, because they talk about at the end of Acts 34 the sharing of believers and the, amongst believers, and they talk about Barnabas, who was this really upright guy who came and laid some stuff at the apostles' feet. And then Acts 5 says, but contrasting what Barnabas did, a man named Ananias with his wife Sapphira, sold a piece of property, and they kept back some of the price for himself and his wife's full knowledge, and with his wife's full knowledge, and bringing a portion of it, he laid it at the apostles' feet. So he basically, what he did is he said, hey, you know, we have this property, I'm going to sell this land, this new movement is coming out, this, you know, we're a part of this, we believe in Jesus, everybody's selling, everybody's helping, I just sold my land for $50,000, but you know what, honey, listen, let's just tell them we sold it for $30,000. Because that way we can keep 20 for ourselves. That's what he did. Peter said to Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and keep back some of the price of the land? While it remained unsold, didn't it remain your own? In other words, he wasn't compelled to do this by the apostles. He didn't say, you have to do this or you're not a Christian. After it was sold, was it not under your control? Why is it that you conceive this deed in your heart? You've not lied to men, but to God. And as Ananias heard these words, he fell down and he breathed his last, and great fear came over all who heard of it. The young men got up, covered him up, and carried him out, and they buried him. So Ananias and his wife lied to the apostles, sold the price for a land for one price, and gave the apostles much less. Now, right after that, his wife comes in. She's not knowing what's going on. And Peter basically says, is this what happened? Did you sell this property for such and such a price? And she said, yes. Now, he doesn't say to her, why did Satan fill your heart? He says something else. He says to her in verse 9, why is that you've agreed together to put the Spirit of the Lord to the test? And now she gets struck down. In Scripture, this is called miraculous instant judgment. We see it throughout Scripture, not a lot, but we do see it here and there. And God, basically, instead of waiting until judgment day, in order to accomplish a purpose here and now, he executes judgment. Now, we have a couple of things that we want to look at here. We want to see, number one, Satan filled the heart of Ananias. Number two, they equally agreed to test the Spirit of God. And now, does anybody remember when Jesus was in the wilderness in Matthew 4? Satan came and they tempted him. Remember, he brought him up at the top of the building and he said, "Why don't you jump down?" He says, "God will save you." And Jesus says, "It is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Now, Jesus was quoting an Old Testament passage. If you go back to Exodus 17, you will see that the Israelites were just rescued out of Egypt and they were complaining to Moses. They were saying, "Why'd you bring us out here to die? We don't even have any water. We're gonna dehydrate out here." And Moses got frustrated and God said, "Go strike that rock and give them water." And that first part of that chapter is all about, this is where the Israelites put God to the test by saying, is the Lord truly among us or not? So Ananias and Sapphira, number one, this is what they did. They underestimated Satan, their number one opponent. You see, as soon as we give Satan a little bit of a toehold in our life, we start to entertain sin just a little tiny bit. Satan then gets a grappling move on us and he grabs on and he starts to pull us down and starts to pull us under. Now, their specific sin was that of hypocrisy. They were trying to show everybody that look how good we are. We're giving this money and we're not holding back. Okay? They're trying to say they're the word hypocrite comes from the word actor in the Greek. In other words, they were acting in front of people. So Satan then filled their heart. Now, once Satan fills you, now you are going to start to give yourself over more and more to that sin. The second thing they did is they underestimated their sinful flesh. They started to entertain, because look, we have Satan filling, but also it says, why is it that this deed was conceived in your own heart? So it's not just Satan, oh man, Satan just filled me, I have nothing, I can't do anything about it. No. You let Satan fill your heart, but then your flesh starts to join along with it. And then the real underlying sin was that they tested the Lord. What has God done in your life, right? What has He done in your life that's so absolutely amazing, that's so absolutely powerful, that's so absolutely evident of the presence of God? At that point, if you question God and you say, is He truly here? You're putting God to the test. And you know, you have to look at it too, that these people also underestimated God's judgment. They underestimated God's judgment. Because here's what's happening. You have the beginning of the church. God is looking at this church and He is looking to purify this church. And He chose to swiftly bring about fear to get everybody's head right. And He brought this instant miraculous judgment. So, what do we learn from this? Number one, Satan is real. I don't know if you guys have ever heard of William Carroll. He's the Death Angel drummer. There's actually a group out there. It's called Satanic Metal, Satanic Heavy Metal. And basically, the name of the group is called Death Angel. And a couple of weeks ago, this guy, William Carroll, ended up getting COVID-19. And Loudwire.com put out an article saying that this man was in a chemically induced coma because he was so sick. And he had a vivid experience. You know how some people have afterlife experiences with God and they see the light? Well, this guy swears up and down that he went down into the pits of hell. And I won't describe some of the things that he saw because it's just not edifying to hear some of these things. But this guy came out of the coma and he said, you know what? Satan is real. The problem is he basically just said, yeah, I'm going to cut out on heavy drinking and I'm going to cut back on my smoking and drugs. And currently he's in therapy trying to strengthen himself mentally and physically after this ordeal. Now, he won't underestimate the reality of Satan. But I'm telling you that as a believer in Christ, Satan is not going to come to you and bring you down to the depths of hell. He's going to come to you as an angel of light. He's going to come to you in a beautiful white gown. He's going to come to you in the form of a beautiful woman or a beautiful man. Or He's going to come to you exactly where your weak point is, like He did with the New Testament church. Don't underestimate Satan in your life. C.S. Lewis says the two biggest mistakes is that everybody thinks Satan's doing everything. That's not right. And he also says, this is in the Screwtape Letters. Or on the other side is they think Satan loves that when you don't believe in him. Because now you're at his right in the palm of his hand. So tactic number two, we talked about confronting. So tactic number one is don't underestimate Satan. And obviously don't underestimate God's judgment. Number two is we must confront our opponent with God-specific techniques and confidence head-on when we cannot retreat. So the apostles here, now if you look, one thing I want to tell you is that if you look at after God struck down Ananias and Sapphira, the beautiful thing about God is that after He disciplines and after He purges, He always responds in love and in comfort. So right after this, He starts to do more miracles at the hands of the apostles. People are bringing their sick out. People are bringing the demon-possessed out. Peter's walking by, their shadow's falling on them, and they're getting healed. So the love of God was the ultimate goal of what God did. And then again, in verse 17, as our second point is about to be commenced, we see the word but. Luke uses but throughout this whole scripture. Because all that good stuff is happening, but what happens? The high priest rises up along with all his associates, and they were filled with jealousy, indignation. Now you see, Acts chapter 5 is contrasting the filling of the Holy Spirit. Remember, in all the first couple chapters of Acts, everybody's getting filled with the Holy Spirit. Everybody's great. Everything's good. But now God's showing us Satan fills. He's our opponent, and also other people are our opponent. They get filled with indignation. They take the apostles, and now they put them in a public jail. This is no longer the temple jail. This is a public jail. See, there's nobody around. There's no miracle here. So they're not afraid of the people stoning them, saying, oh, this guy just did a miracle of God, and you're putting him in jail? No, that didn't happen. They were filled with indignation and jealousy and all the reasons we talked about in Acts chapter 4. They get thrown into public jail, and what does God do? He miraculously sends an angel at night and opens the gates of the prison, and he tells them to go stand and speak to the people in the temple the whole message of this life. And upon hearing this, they entered into the temple about daybreak, and they began to teach. Now, this is an amazing thing, because God doesn't say, you know, go and retreat. He doesn't say, oh yeah, this isn't going to work out. You know, maybe we should have Zoom meetings, you know, because they had Zoom meetings back then too. So they brought everybody back to their homes to have Zoom meetings. No, they didn't do that. They didn't say, and I'm not knocking Zoom meetings. I'm just saying that God, right at the point of confrontation, he will not stop your calling just because of somebody opposing it. Just because of people being filled with indignation, just because there's a roadblock, God still has a specific calling for you, and he will send you right into the middle of the fight. He will send you right. Why? Because he gives us the training and the techniques in order to combat that. Now, after they got sent right back in the middle, you have all the high priests. They were like, you know, go get the apostles out of jail, and let's have a court session. And they go to the jail, and guess what? The doors are locked. The jails are empty. What happened? Somebody runs up to them, verse 25, and says, hey, those people you put in prison, what are they doing? They're standing and speaking exactly what God told them to do, teaching the people. Teaching the people. You see, we see Satan here attacking the exact specific calling on the apostles' life. Satan knows you. Satan knows your parents. Satan knows your grandparents. Satan knows your great-great-great-great-grandparents. Satan knows what you do behind closed doors. He knows what you bite on. He knows what leads you astray. And believe me, he has a complete FBI file on you. Better and more comprehensive than any CIA agent could ever have. So he will get behind you, and he'll try to blindfold you. He'll get in front of you to try to stop you. And when that doesn't happen, he'll get alongside of you, and he'll start to woo you. Now, how are we supposed to determine all this? Obey God. This one thing here, this is really neat. This guy, I didn't know that there was a church this big, but it's the Yudo Full Gospel Church in Seoul, South Korea. It has 7 services each Sunday and many satellite services. It holds multiple services via the internet, and it can't accommodate, not even on the best day, the whole congregation, which numbers over 800,000 people. This is an assembly of God's church. Now, the pastor's name is Dr. Paul Yonggi Cho. He was converted from Buddhism as a young man. He started this church 50 years ago. And his book that I actually have, I didn't even know that I have it, it's called The Fourth Dimension. He said, once he was asked, how did you build such a great church? He replied, it wasn't me, it was God. All I did was I prayed and I obeyed. Prayed and obeyed. You see, like Krav Maga, right? We have all these cool little techniques to take out somebody quick. Somebody that has no natural ability, okay? I could bring my little daughter up here right now, and she could poke you in the eye and kick you in the groin and hit you in the throat, and you'll be down. Right, Leah? You're dangerous. She doesn't have a lot of natural ability. God doesn't want us to play that. You know what he wants us to do? He wants us to obey where he's called us to go. We have to obey the calling that God has in our life. How do we find out what that calling is? We pray. We pray and we obey. So, that's our technique. That's our absolute training. Now, we have to be bold. We have to be willing to go, but that will happen as we pray and as we obey. Now, the third thing is we have to reconcile the fact that we will get hit. Now, if you look in verse 33, we see another, you know, just want to summarize this. After they were out in the temple preaching, they all rushed over to them, around them, and Peter, like we've read in almost every chapter, preached the gospel to them about Jesus being king, about Jesus being savior, about Jesus rising from the dead. And they were like, it says they were cut to the quick. That means their heart was pierced in verse 33 when they heard, and they wanted to kill them. But there was this really smart preacher called, or teacher of the Jews called Gamaliel. And he started to talk some sense into the Sadducees. And he said, look, let's take a step back. If these people are of God, you're not going to be able to stop them. If they're not of God, they're going to go away. And he starts to use some examples like Thutis, who raised up, and this guy Judas of Galilee. So they took his advice. They said, you know what, we're going to listen to you. But here's the thing, they didn't just let him go. They did something that you and I probably would not even, I don't know if anybody would be able to take this because it's just such a brutal beating, is that they were flogged. Now, a flogging is like a whipping. And it's sometimes they do it with sticks, but sometimes they mostly have a stick with leather strips on the side, and they flog you, and it's 40 lashes, basically 39 lashes. And so they whip you 39 times on the front, on the back. Some countries still use this technique. Most of the Middle Eastern countries, there's not a lot of jail time over there. You do something that's a federal crime or a state crime or any type of religious crime, they flog you and then they let you go. I read about one guy got sentenced to 1,500 lashes. 50 a week. Incredible. I don't know how these guys did it. Well, this is what happened to these apostles. They were flogged and they were ordered not to speak in the name of Jesus. Okay? Now, this is another tactic with the enemy. The enemy will intimidate you through either physical pain, or he will intimidate you through psychological pain. Like I was saying with Krav Maga, one of the things that I didn't like about it was once you got up there a little bit and you started doing it for a while, you had to start training and getting hit. I didn't want to get hit. And I thought maybe I was just a big old wimp, but then I looked and I started doing some research and I started talking to some people that I know how to box and that have been in the ring. Jay probably understands this. Nobody likes to get hit, right? Nobody likes to get hit. It's a mental thing. You have to get over that. You have to get over taking that punch. And once you learn how to take that punch, it becomes easier and easier. You see, they say to start to spar lightly and then start to increase the training and then put on smaller mitts and you take it up and then you gradually overcome that fear. But the whole thing has to do with attitude. And the apostles, right here, are being taught to endure. After they got flogged, what did they do? They rejoiced when they went on their way. And they thought that it was worth, they said, we have been considered worthy to suffer shame for his name. And every day in the temple, from house to house, they kept right on teaching and preaching that Jesus is the Christ. They stayed focused. They had three major confrontations, three major opponents. They, number one, had the opponent of Satan trying to get his hands inside the church and cause division and cause hypocrisy and set an example and cause God to be mocked. God came and took care of it and responded with miracles and grew the church. Then they were the religious people were filled. Their opponents right around them came after them. People in their own town, in their own neighborhood, the people that they grew up with, right there, they came against them. They got thrown into jail. See, the enemy wants to constrain us. He wants to contain us. God miraculously broke them out. And what did they do? They went forward with their calling. And then the persecution increased more. The problems increased more. See, when you, especially when you first become a Christian, I don't like when people say, Jesus and God has a great plan for you. Everything's going to be great. God, let me just tell you, there's nothing, that's why they said, go tell everybody, go preach, go stand and speak the word. They didn't say just go speak the gospel. Go speak the words of this life. This life is so glorious to know the living God. But it doesn't, it's not always easy. It's like this. Okay, but every hill, every turn, your joy exponentially grows. And when you know what God has given you and shown you to do, you go out and you take action and you do it and you don't look back. One of my favorite quotes, I used to have this on my refrigerator. I don't know where it went, but it's from Patrick Morley. 10 Secrets for the Man in the Mirror. Great book, especially for midlife crisis people like myself. The Christian life is a broad road of happiness, joy, peace, blessing, success, significance, contentment, which is ironically gained by choosing the narrow road of surrender, obedience, self-denial, self-sacrifice, truth, worship, and service. You see, the narrow road is the way to true joy and happiness. We're deconditioned for that. We're saying, no, happiness is me getting what I want, making money, having things, feeling good, having pleasure. And God's saying, go ahead, try it. Let me know when you're done. And guess what? Then we get a vision from God. We get a purpose. And then we take that route, that narrow road, and it becomes an ultimate, incredible joy to do it and to give up your life. It's a joy. Acts 5 is about regular Christians being used and giving their life to the battle of their calling by not underestimating their opponent, by using that pray and obey tactic, and by really not being afraid when things go wrong. When things start to get bad, when you start to get hit, you keep moving forward. Memorial Day just passed. That's about those that sacrificed for something and someone they loved. You see, people, soldiers on the battlefield don't just die for their country. They die for what their country represents to the people that they love. It's that freedom, right? It's where that came from. There was a guy in the Second World War. His name was John Robert Fox. He was an American soldier. He was killed in action when he deliberately called artillery fire on his own position after his position was overrun and greatly outnumbered by Germans. He was a lieutenant. He called in the coordinates, and they said, sir, but you don't understand. That's right where you are. He says, actually, it's about 50 yards from where I'm at. Move it over 50 more yards. He says, sir, I can't do that. He says it's an order. And he brought down artillery fire on his own position in order to save the lives of the rest of the people that were behind him, that were moving up. After acknowledging this danger, he insisted that the last adjustment would be fired. It was the only way to defeat the attacking soldiers. By sacrificing himself, he succeeded in defeating a German attack in northern Italy during this World War II, and there were over 100 Germans that were eliminated. He was awarded the Medal of Honor after his death in 1997. What is that a picture of? That's a picture of Jesus Christ right there. That's a picture of Jesus dying on the cross for us. Not for the land necessarily, but for the world, because it was rightfully his. It was for the freedom that his people would have to be able to fully serve God. But God, when he died on the cross, he didn't just do it to give us an everlasting eternity. He did it because he wants you to experience the joy of being part of this whole process. And how? What is that whole process? It's your specific calling. So go to Christ. Use him as the example. He is the one that did this. He didn't underestimate Satan. He went head on with the word of God and his faithfulness, and he knew that he was going to get hit. right? He knew what was about to happen to him. He is our example, people. I think that this Acts chapter 5 is a great encouragement for us as we go forward in this new world that we're about to live in. Ask yourself what God's got you to do. I don't care if you're 12, 16, 18, 35. I don't care if you're a teacher, you're a homeschool mom, you're a filmmaker, you're whatever you are, football coach, whatever it is. What does God have for your life? Don't look back. Don't look back. Don't let anybody stop you. You go forward to what God has given you because He'll be there for you. He'll be there. Why? Because Jesus has set the example.